This gathering, my name is Karthik Narayan Sharma and I head growth and strategy at Sunshore Energy. I'm going to take you through our perspective on a very, very important topic which seems to have been left out largely by this conference, which is on the grid stability side. So I'll start out by telling you guys a little bit about Sunshore and what we do. So we are a pure play EPC company and we deal with commercial and industrial rooftop plants as well as utility scale plants. We've also worked on an open access ground mounted project, which is a 5.5 megawatt captive project with trackers in Haryana and is largely the first of its kind in the state. Overall, we are running towards a 40 megawatt installed capacity by the end of this financial year. And you can see some of our most prestigious customers right here on this slide. What we want to do as a company is to basically, you know, accelerate India's transition to a renewable energy prime nation, and we are targeting to install close to 2 gigawatts by 2022. We intend on doing this by putting both large scale ground mounted and commercial industrial rooftop plants, as well as you know, provide world class operations and maintenance to these. The team is, we are a team consisting primarily of IIT and IIM alumni, started in 2014. And now we are a team of over 60 engineers and financial experts with over 500 megawatts of cumulative experience. Something that I came across at the beginning of this financial year and was probably one of the best graphs that I've seen all of this year was, you know, the parity of renewable energy capacity addition with thermal capacity addition last year. So this is a major landmark, you know, for our country, where, you know, this, after this financial year, we're really running towards becoming a renewable energy prime nation. Now, this clearly is a disruption, and with all disruptions, there is, you know, a certain few things that industry folks need to do in order to tame it, in order to make sure that, you know, the country smoothly transitions off. So I'm just putting down here the top four that according to us. Number one is, of course, creating high quality assets, and that's what this gathering is all about. Mr. Gautam spoke about, you know, how, what is the cutting edge in solar modules. Then we've heard on inverters from Huawei. Of course, DuPont has been a company which has been continuously supporting all kinds of technology disruptions over 100 plus years. And the next thing, and the next biggest challenge, which, you know, all other nations in the world are facing, especially America and Europe, is grid integration of these intermittent power producing assets like solar and wind. Then for our country, as we all know, and we've all heard about this as well, you know, even in terms of standards from Amrish ji, that you know, the Indian context on development of technology in the world is largely missing, right? And we really need to foster research and innovation for the Indian context, keeping both of these things, creating high quality assets as well as grid integration, in our minds. And the fourth and a very, very crucial point is human capital. One thing that all of us, especially, you know, all companies which are doing EPC in the country face, is the lack of trained human capital. We find a lot of people who know how to, you know, do work at the site, which is, you know, run of the mill work. But when it comes to really thinking for themselves and figuring out new innovative ways of cutting down costs at the field and during the design phase, that's one place where we are seriously lacking talent. Also in the operations and maintenance field, there is a serious lack of human capital. Another place where, you know, human capital is key is the analytics in solar power, in the solar power industry. So just to take you guys through the vision that we have as a company, we are currently focusing on creating sustainable energy assets, maximizing the energy generation from these assets, and reducing the operating costs. This largely is also a reflection of what the entire industry is focusing on right now. But what we really need for the future in order to make our country a green energy driven nation is to increase the reliability of these assets that we are putting up. There are so many questions even on, you know, the warrantied life of panels and inverters and most of the BOS components. And then the last one is to enable flexibility and control. Why thermal power plants and you know, nuclear power plants and the such were such a powerful and such a popular choice for the past were because of the flexibility and control that these plants offered. for renewable energy assets to really offer the kind of flexibility and control that matches and, you know, gives a tough real challenge to these conventional sources of energy, we are going to need energy storage and smarter grids. I'll talk a little bit more about this smart grid in the next slide. So in this slide, I want to present what we feel is the grid of the future. Number one is primarily distributed energy resources, which is rooftop solar, solar plus storage, hybrid wind and solar, and so on, a lot of biogas and so on. But basically, turning the current energy paradigm on its head from a centralized model to a decentralized model. The next thing, very, very crucial to really decentralizing energy production, is energy storage. And then the third and very, very important field or cog in this wheel is electric vehicles and charging infrastructure. 70% of our urban pollution is owed to transportation and not to power production. And to improve the quality of life, especially all of us are sitting in Delhi, right? Last year was terrible for the city. I myself suffered, and this is something which is very, very close to our hearts at Sunshore as well. We really, really want to bring down this level of pollution in the country, and EVs and charging infrastructure is the way forward in order to really make an impact there. And the last one here that I want to talk about is network security and resilience. We have all the power production that we're doing now is, all of those infrastructure is very, very smart. Huawei has really changed the game with, bringing in inverters, which can now, allow you to do IV curve testing and so on from, remotely, which was earlier a very, very, or still is an extremely tedious task. So with all of this smartness and all of this communication, being recorded from our energy infrastructure, and this will also percolate in the EVs and so on, we need to work a lot on the security of these networks. A lot of you guys must have heard about blockchain and its applications in energy. That is also one of those technologies which is really going to help us create a more resilient and secure network of how our nation uses and produces its energy. So these four things is according to us the most important cogs in the wheel to create the grid of the future. And these are things that we are really, really focusing on as a company. So with this, I would like to end my speech, and thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Karthikan. Then I will ask Pradeep if you can have the last presentations. Thank you. So after PPA sign, we get a 12 months time, So it is like a one day match, like 50 overs, If you see out of 12 months, 8 months gone for the land acquisition systems, and then therefore you get only 4 months time for your project execution time. So therefore, sometimes if the players initial, two, three players, if they are not getting a good run in the few overs, maybe 25 overs, So asking rate is increasing. So therefore, there is a chance of getting out, or if you have to play all the balls and you have to chase that run. So therefore, if you are going for installations with the same, the situations, so there is a chance of you're making a mistake, Mistake in a sense like after the module which is coming, from the factory, there is a three level of, checking like the yield inspection, blast checking, Then after that, when it is unloading in the site, if the site is not properly prepared, if the ground is not properly labeled, if you are unloading your pallets, and if you are not taking properly, there are different do's and don'ts, you have to follow, So therefore, the pressure on the O&M side, we have seen the O&M, there are, in the project side, the modules is the major failure, there is a called as a infant failure, means within 2 to 3 months, there is an early failure and there is a long-term failure. Early failures may be another within 5 years' time, and then the long-term failure is within 15 years' time, So these modules are the major, I'll say the cost drivers, like 60% of the whole project cost, We had seen that the inverter side, there are a little fault, like any card is not working, or you have to replace those cards, But on a project perspective, when after installations on the O&M side, roughly the ballpark figure, you take like 1% of the whole project cost, you know, per annum is the cost that we take into the account. And majority it comes from the module cleaning, then your vegetations and the other things, the grass cleaning and all, then your security staff, like that, you know, and then you have so many, at least 4 or 5 people, you know, on the project side, you know, for their, you know, continuous movement and taking the data, you know. To maintain the health of this module, you know, there are several, I'll say, tools, on the diagnostic tools has come. Say, for example, the module is performing or not, you can check through the IV meter. You know, you can check the really IV curve of the module as well as to the string level, you know. There is a thermal imager, you know, if there is any kind of a hot spot, you know, because of the bird drop or because of the soiling, you know. So soiling is another, you know, area we have to look into the point, you know, like depending on the locations, like if it is in the Gujarat, if it is in Rajasthan, or if it is in the other Andhra, you know. So whether the twice in a month or thrice in a month, you know, you have to see, you know, reference to your the module, you know, how it has to be clean, and the cleaning has to be, you know, proper in a sense, like, you know, the rubbing of the material, what is the material that you are going to use it, and also the water, you know, if it is not a hard water, doesn't stick on the anti-reflection coating of the module, you know. There is another tools, you know, which is called is a drone-based infrared imaging, you know, if your power plant is more than 50 megawatt, you know, and you have a 250 not 250, it is maybe 750 acres of land, you know, 250 acres of land, you know. So sometimes it's through the manual, you know, checking, it's not possible. So drone-based infrared imaging as well as through the visual inspections, you can do it, you know. The last but not is the EL inspections. You know, what is that EL inspections? As you know, if we have some sort of you know, a crack in our bone, we do the X-ray checking, you know, through the X-ray we understand, you know, there is a crack in our body. Similar things in the module, you know, what you do is called electroluminescent test, you know, EL test, you know. What does it do actually? In the forward biasing, depending on the ISC and the VOC, 10% of the, you know, extra of your ISC and the VOC, if you apply, you know, what will happen? Basically the silicon-based material, you know, it excites the silicon atom, and it radiations when it coming down to the ground state, you know. And through the infrared imaging, what happens, there are camera, it is a high speed camera, it take capture, you know, the image of this kind of a in the module and try to find out the defects, you know, I mean kind of a micro crack or any other defects, if there is a black spot or any other things, you know. So there are different diagnostics still. It is very, very important to understand the whole project systems as well as, you know, how you maintained a good health of your power plant, you know. So I'll ask Mr. Agnihotri, you know, he's here, you know. As you know, in 2010, we didn't have a very good design on the mounting systems. You know, there is a fixed mounting system. Now there is a seasonal mounting, you know, and also coming in the tracker system. How it improves the performance on the, you know, the power generations through the different, I'll say, you know, innovations, you know, if you give some idea on that.
Listening to you in the past on the various O&M things, and we know that your expertise in this region is really something which you can look forward to. Coming back to the topic for discussion, before we are talking about the topic for discussion today, I would just like briefly to introduce our company. Oriano has been in the solar EPC business for the last 5 years. We started with solar thermal. We did a plant of 50 megawatts in called Godavari. And in PV, we have been there for last 3 years. And we did 2 megawatts in the first year, 50 megawatts in the next year. And this year, we should be touching somewhere around 100 megawatts. Overall, roughly somewhere around 175 megawatts is what we have done till date. But more importantly, what we are more proud about is, as somebody else in the panel was mentioning, that you have to be on the technology curve at the right time. We should not enter a technology when the technology is maturing. So we can very proudly say that we did a non-penetrative structure, a rooftop structure, around 4 years back, and there was a lot of media attention also on that, and we got appreciation for a customer, basically it was Sun Edison. So we got a appreciation letter also for that. And again, on the 1500 volt technology, if we talk about, we have done some 50 megawatts for that Karnataka along with GE. So that is what I was just briefly trying to say, that we have also got to be very sure that we are on the technology at the right time. So if you, and there is a right new technology which has several advantages, you have to be there at the right time. Now, coming back to the topic for discussion, which is like what I have been asked to speak generally about the mounting structures. Whenever you are designing a mounting structure, there are two, three objectives that you are basically looking for. One is the efficiency, how much really can you gather in respect of the fact what, considering whatever the constraints of the soil or the roof are there. So keeping all those in mind, what is the best efficiency that you can get out of it? And the second is the durability or the ruggedness of the structure. It should not happen that you have a very efficient structure, but the structure does not last long. So you are hitting the life of the plant in a way. So these are two predominant structure apart, two predominant objectives while designing any structure. Now, if you go for, say, a rooftop structure, there are three, four predominant types of mounting structures that are available in the market. One is the rail-based, wherein you put a C-section or a L-section parallel to the roof, and then you clamp the modules onto it. The other is where you do it directly onto the clamping is done directly on the roof. Third, as I discussed, was the non-penetrative structure that we, like I told you about a project that we have done in Madurai for Sanadison. So in the non-penetrative structure, your roof does not get disturbed. There's no, especially for RCC structures where the area is very thin, or even otherwise, even if you have a very thick roof, even then, people typically do not want their roofs to be disturbed. And finally, there are pallet structures, which very minimal amount of penetration happens in the roof, but predominantly the structure is standing on the basis or on the strength of the pallet, where or a ballast, what you can say, so that it does not really get carried away or anything. So that ballast gives it the strength for which can take the wind load. Coming to the ground mount structures, we have rows, like as Sarah was mentioning about single axis, dual axis and fixed tail. So for single axis, we typically have rows, while for dual axis, we have tables because we have to move in the both directions. So you have to, one more point that, again, on the technology side, on the rooftop, was like the new innovation is now the singles that Tesla has probably come out, and now I have heard that Everest is also coming out in India, where the panels are like embedded in the structure of the, while it can happen only at the time of the designing of the roof, but now there is no penetration, or you are basically designing your concrete and your electrical, both the things are meshed in, or in a such a way that your electrical circuit is embedded in the roof. So that is the new advantage, so that does not have any kind of a stability issue, it will always be there. That was on the rooftop. So coming back to ground mount, we were talking about fixed, single axis and dual axis. So these are the three predominant structures that are mounting structures that we are there for ground mount systems. So within which we can design and improve efficiency for each of them. Yeah.
Thank you. Achha, I will ask Mr. B.S. Arun about the Tata projects, the activities, what they are doing, you know. So please explain in the 5 minutes.
Good evening. My name is Arun Kumar, and I'm representing Tata projects. And they're also into EPC. There is one Tata International, which is doing EPC. Internationally, also local. And we have also a plant which was been acquired by Tata, which is a Wellspun plant, which has got a different vertical altogether. And Tata project is basically doing inspection testing services for solar PV power plant. So this is a small brief description of what we are doing. I'm being the last speaker, I suppose. I think some more people are there to discuss, I suppose. I just wanted, on the lighter note, how many of you know Nirav Modi? Everyone knows, or someone doesn't know about Nirav Modi? One good thing he has done is he has left India with a 70 megawatt plant in Ahmednagar, which you couldn't take it down. Okay, so I'm really happy after having read the news that there is a 70 megawatt of Nirav Modi available for us to do whatever you want, maybe sell or maybe take it off from there. Okay, so that really, that is one part of it. And in the morning, I've been hearing a lot of things which have been happening, especially in the solar field. Okay, I was just wondering, sitting and wondering, we are not playing a sports event in solar, right? It's not a sporting event wherein you put a lot of hurdles and you want guys to pass all the hurdles and finally declare a winner here, right? From the day one, I've been seeing from 2010 onwards, 2010-11, the first the subsidy, people rushed, subsidy withdrawn, many people fell, people couldn't get subsidy. So there was this rooftop which had to really take off. It was almost taken off, crash landed. Okay, then you look at what has happened in case now. Today we are talking about anti-dumping duty. People do not have clarity. Okay, then after that, safeguard duty has come. That before that, there was a GST problem. Till date, there is no clarity on GST. So a lot of issues. The people have been talking about modules got stuck in the port because they had to pay some duty. So how many more hurdles you want the solar industry to undergo? Today, the secretary of MNRE was here. I posed a question to him. After 8 long years, you want to bring a standard for solar modules. 8 long years, almost passed. Now, what happens to these poor guys who are manufactured, who already got IEC certification? Please note this fact. To get an IEC certification, we require more than 6 months of testing to be done at lab. And you have to pay in crores sometimes. What happens to these guys? This is one of the biggest hurdles. And I couldn't get a correct answer. Today, there is already a resolution passed in the Gazette that it has to come out with an ISA mark. So what happens during this period? How many people, more than 100 manufacturers worldwide, if they have to sell the panel in India, they have to take up ISI certification, which will take around roughly around 3 to 4 months. In this 3 to 4 months, how are the projects which are already given PPAs going to come up? Or are they going to withdraw these things? This is something, I mean, the challenge which is happening in the solar field. Hurdle after hurdle, hurdle after hurdle, there are a lot of hurdles. This is something which I think if someone can take it up with the government and say, enough is enough now. Let this solar industry grow first. For the first 10 years, let it grow. After which, whatever you intend to do, let us do it. Now, at this juncture, if you say, I have to certify my order for ISI, and how many people are going to get this done? And how many labs are there? Let us understand this principle. How many labs are there to cater to this requirement of about 50 odd manufacturers to come? And if you take five months or 6 months for a module to get certified as an ISI, what happens during this period? Leave it Chinese or any other modules I'm talking about, even modules coming from other places. So this, no one has thought about it. It's something like, you know, you need to make these people understand, the policy makers, to make them understand how it is affecting. Right? Now, coming to some of these O&M, because of all these factors which have come, the O&M price, what Jaggi was telling me, was around 4 lakhs. Now it has dropped to 2 lakhs. So can you do an O&M at 2 lakhs per megawatt per annum? Just impossible. Just impossible. Here again, you are hit here. And you want the industry to grow. Why do you want to bring this reverse auction into place, first of all? Let the industry grow for about 6 to 7 years without any interruption. Then you bring whatever you want. Today, the tariff has come down to such a level. I don't know when they'll make the break even. We were just calculating some time back. Even at 5 rupees or 6 rupees, it takes about 7 to 8 years for the plant to break even. Now with 2.44 or 2.3 or less than that, it will take more than 15 years by the time half the plant life is gone. So these are some of the things which came to my mind. I thought, let me share with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Arunji. Now we can go to Mr. Rahul from the GE Power. So you give your companies some background and then whatever you want to say.
Yeah, good afternoon to all of you. Thanks for EQ for inviting. GE is a tradition of thin film modules, which later on they sold it to First Solar. After that, GE has come up with a technology of inverters of 1500 volt. Globally, we already sold around 3 gigawatt of installation. And India, we started operations in 2016, where we were facing the problem because India was totally on 1000 volt market. So around 1 year, we took for convincing the developers to go on a 1500 volt from 1000 volt. Because that time, supply chain was not available for 1500 volt module, 1500 volt balance of materials, modules, 1500 manufacturers of 1500 modules are less, price difference was there. So it took almost 1 year to convince the developers to go on the 1500 volt module. After end of 2016, we got a big installation of 140 megawatt in Badla, which was on completely 1500 volt. Later on, now everybody has come up with the 1500 volt system in India. And later on, by end of 2017, we have started our manufacturing in Chennai for ground mounted inverters, where we are manufacturing 1 megawatt to later on we are coming out a new inverter which is 3.125 large in block size, so that we can increase the block size at DC level, so to decrease the BOS cost. Presently, GE has parallelly started EPC work for complete ground mounted solar. We started by end of 2016, by end of March 18, we'll be close to commissioning around 600 megawatt. In this, some are with ACBS, some are with complete EPC. And in some cases, complete with modules. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. We have got another 15 minutes time, so I will ask each panelist one-on-one questions, you know, just one. I'll ask Mayank first, you know, because he has a experience in inverter, you know.
Let's welcome Mr. Weber from he's heading the rooftop division at Jackson Solar. So he'll also join in this panel. Let's welcome him with a big round of applause. Actually, there's a big VIP movement and there's a lot of traffic jam, so because of which there's some last minute juggling up, and hence we are merging the two sessions. So let's welcome Mr. Weber.
I'm from Jackson Solar Engineers Limited. I head rooftop division for the Jackson. Jackson is a well-diversified group. We have electrical DNA. We started with genset somewhere around 70 years back, and since last 5 years, we are into EPC, both rooftop and land base. In rooftop, we have around 300 megawatts of installed base, and for land base, we have 300 megawatt of installed base. Rooftop, we are above 50 megawatts, and another 10-20 megawatts are there which are under INC. So this has been an interesting journey for Jackson. We have grown with the industry, we have grown with the country, and if you talk about the recent scenario of the solar industry, especially about rooftop, so we talk about O&M activities, we talk about trackers, and we talk about different cleaning activities. As far as I see in India, it's being done mechanically or manually today. Water is the major component which is being used. We have to go a long way to adopt the technologies which are there in the West. We have to benchmark with them so that we can reduce the use of water, which is again a very, very important and very resource, very, very important resource. Going forward, we should move towards using air to clean the modules, robotics, a company. Trackers, as we know, that they require more space. They are they increase efficiency by 20-25%. And we are working towards that to get that kind of technology on the rooftop as well. Land-based, it has done miracles in increasing efficiency and IRRs of the plant, which are already installed. And we are really looking forward for the day when this technology can be taken to the rooftop and we can add value to the rooftops as well. Thank you.